It's interesting in terms of vaccines to wonder why there's all this excitement and all this interest in essentially a new form of vaccines at this time. And as Jim indicated, the vaccines that we're now dealing with are today are considered through a relatively new method of producing vaccines, and that is using recombinant DNA technology to use a vector and put in a desired gene that will express an antigen that will immunize somebody. Now, if one goes back historically and you think in terms of recombinant DNA when it got started and the horror stories that were told about what was going to happen, and the indication was that if we ever did the sort of thing that we're doing now, that instead of having a vaccine, a virus that didn't produce anything, if you put in a foreign gene, it's going to make it a horror and the world will be dead very soon. Well, clearly this isn't true. Then the next question one might ask is why, since there have been so many successful vaccines, do we even need a new method? I mean, after all, we're still basking in the glory of eradicating smallpox with a vaccine. There's been tremendous success with poliomyelitis with a vaccine, with measles, with mumps, and a variety of others. So the question then is why do we need this new technique? What I'd like to do today, if I can, is to discuss the objectives of what new vaccine's about and how we're going to look at it. First, I'd like to review what a successful vaccine is. Then I would wish to discuss the successful vaccines that we have today, and finally, what major vaccines we need, and why don't we continue making them the way we made successful vaccines before. If we're going to have a good vaccine, whether it be a vector vaccine or the old one, in the first place, it must be one that does not produce any adverse reactions. Now, they can be of several types. One, they can be of just the direct effect of the vaccine that one gives. In other words, even with vaccinia and the vaccine with smallpox, children that had congenital cellular defects in their immunity had very severe reactions, often leading to death. One can look at another type of a reaction, even the successful flu vaccine today. It's not unusual, 12 to 24 hours after receiving the vaccine, to have a syndrome very similar to influenza. But there can be even worse things, and that is two types of vaccines that had been made, one against respiratory syncytial virus and one against measles virus, which was a commonly made vaccine by inactivating the virus with formaldehyde. And what happened is these people got perfectly good antibody responses and had no direct effect as a result of the vaccine given to them. But 2 years afterwards, if they got the natural disease, the disease was actually much more severe than the common one, than the ordinary disease that these viruses would produce. And also, there are some vaccines experimental vaccines in which subsequent immunization had become worse. Now, clearly, the vaccine, if it's going to be successful, must produce the appropriate immune response in the appropriate time. Ordinarily, we've been accustomed to looking at neutralizing antibodies. But we're now facing at least one disease, AIDS, in which this may not be adequate, and that we may need to produce an immunity of a cellular type, particularly if the infecting virus enters in cells rather than as free virus. And finally, a successful vaccine must have immunity of sufficient duration. Now, how do we come to this reaction? Now, I'm not going to go into this slide in detail, but it's important to understand what neutralization is, because the ability of a vaccine that produces humoral immunity, that is, antibodies that circulate in our blood, must be able to neutralize the virus. And so one must make an antigen in every viral protein. Every protein of a virus that's antigenic and makes antibodies does not produce neutralizing antibodies. So it's very important to understand exactly what neutralizing antibodies are. And I find going around the country and even giving some lectures in people's courses places that there's great confusion about viral neutralization. So I thought that I would bring it up today at this group. It's a reversible reaction. If you add antigen and antibody, but I can do better with this, they tell me. I won't try. The virus, when it reacts with the antibody, follows a law of mass action, which means that it forms an antigen-antibody reaction, which is then reversible. The most important part is that it follows single-hit kinetics. Can't see it on that screen, that's the problem. That is that it doesn't require large amounts of antibodies to neutralize a virus particle. It takes some place, and it depends upon the virus, between 1 and 4 antibody molecules. It doesn't require a huge amount of antibody, and you can understand the need for this for a successful vaccine. For the antibodies to be effective, we cannot have in our blood over any period of time antibodies that will neutralize at very high concentrations. And so you can't cover all the sites on the virus with the antibodies. So it really only takes 1 to 4 antibody molecules to neutralize a virus. It's not an antibody that necessarily prevents adsorption to the cell, because every virus has a large number of components by which it can attach to a cell. And if it required that every one of those attachment sites was covered by an antibody, we would have great trouble in attaining an antibody titer that could accomplish this task. It's not antibodies that merely produce aggregation of the virus. In some way, and this is a step which is the heart of the matter and which is still not fully understood, in some way that 1 to 4 antibody molecules prevents the uncoating of the virus so that the genome of the virus can get into the cell. Now that's what our vaccine must satisfy if it's going to be one that produces humoral immunity. So we must determine what is the antigen that produces neutralizing antibodies before we begin to make vaccines. And unfortunately for some of our major diseases today, that still has not been determined. Now here are the successful vaccines that we have today. It's quite clear that the most successful one is smallpox. It has had tremendous success. It's the first vaccine that was ever developed, and it's been our most successful, because it has indeed eradicated the disease. Poliomyelitis has been extremely successful, both the live virus vaccine and the killed virus vaccine, which has been used differently in different parts of the world, have both had prominent success. So we don't have to argue as to whether one should have a killed virus vaccine or a live virus vaccine on the basis of poliomyelitis, but really on the disease and the virus that we're working with. The live virus vaccine for measles has likewise been extremely successful, as has that for rubella, yellow fever, which is another very old one. Adenoviruses, although it's not commonly used as a vaccine, is widely used in the armed forces to prevent disease that recruits get, and that has been an extremely successful vaccine. Rabies has had a somewhat varied history, and the complete benefit of rabies vaccine as we use it today is still not as clear in humans. It's certainly a very valuable vaccine in animals. We're just getting to the use of hepatitis A and B vaccines, and from the experimental data, and they've not been widely used yet, certainly hepatitis B, done with the surface antigen of the virus, appears to be quite a successful vaccine, and hepatitis A also seems to be following. And again, varicella zoster virus, which produces chickenpox, has not been used extensively yet, but it's been used in a very critical population, that is young children who for one reason or another are getting transplants and they're getting drugs that suppress their immunity. They to prevent reactivation primarily of the varicella zoster virus, they have been immunized and it's been very successful thus far. Well, now if that's so, what then are the vaccines that we really need today? And clearly heading the list is the causative agent, or at least I believe is the causative agent, AIDS, and I didn't see Peter Duesberg walk in, so I guess it's all right that I can still say that. But that, as we all recognize, is a very serious disease and one in which a vaccine is badly and tragically needed. Non-A, non-B hepatitis, which is now the prominent type of hepatitis that is affecting the world, also commonly, most often transmitted in blood transfusion, is badly needed, as is hepatitis D, or the Delta agent, which is commonly carried along with hepatitis B. Rotaviruses, which can produce very severe disease, gastrointestinal disease in children, and is being prominently worked on here at the NIH by the leaders of the world in the field. And the same holds for respiratory syncytial virus, which is a very severe respiratory disease in young children, and that too is receiving great attention here at the National Institutes of Health. Parainfluenza virus, which is closely related in the same family as respiratory syncytial virus, also produces severe respiratory diseases in children. And we all know about the common cold virus. We've been wishing for a vaccine against the common cold for many years, and it's really a very difficult field because there's at least 113, it's probably more, different types that are immunologically distinct that can rhinoviruses that produce the common cold, so that becomes very difficult. Some recently, that is within the last few years, adenoviruses that produce also severe gastrointestinal disease in children, types 40 and 41. Dengue virus has been haunting us for a long time, and if one read the newspaper a couple of days ago, we realized that it's becoming prominent again, and the world would be very much better off with a dengue virus vaccine. Two other encephalitis vaccines, equine encephalitis, which is not uncommon in the United States and certainly more common in other parts of the world, Japanese B encephalitis, and the string of herpes viruses, herpes simplex 1 and 2, cytomegalovirus, Epstein-Barr virus, and clearly one could add more, and you recognize this is just diseases of humans. If one thinks in terms of the diseases by which a vaccine would be very important in the animal, in the veterinary world, this becomes a huge list. So what are we going to do about it? I want to recall for you what the successful vaccines were. And you see, it's not entirely clear as to whether live virus, that is attenuated virus, or killed virus vaccine is going to be the most successful. Smallpox was eradicated using an attenuated virus. It really wasn't even a smallpox virus, but a very closely related virus, vaccinia virus, which was employed. dating back to the days of Jenner. Poliomyelitis, you can have either a living or killed, and we've been through this, so there's no clear evidence as to what type of virus was needed. But if we think in terms of some of the diseases that I showed you on the last slide, and it becomes clear that we couldn't possibly go approach a disease such as AIDS with a virus that was living, because we'd have no way to test its virulence. It would be impossible to know whether it would produce disease or whether it was, even though we played with a lot of genes, I think the possibility of testing a virus that was alive in humans would be impossible, and we have no good animal model to date. We couldn't even, I think it would be very difficult, although the agencies may tell us different, that it may be very difficult to even test a killed virus vaccine in humans, if we thought we had a chance of doing it. So if we think in those terms, then that gives us a clue as to why there has been such great interest generated in vector vaccines. Now, by a vector vaccine, what we mean is choosing a virus as the vector that is avirulent, or essentially avirulent. And that's why Bernie Moss and his colleagues particularly look to vaccinia virus. Now, I hope none of Congressman Dingell's representatives are here, because I'm going to do a lot of perjury today. And this first slide is certainly an example of it, because Bernie Moss gave it to me. So I'll give him credit. I may forget to give credit to everybody else's whose slides I use, but none of the work is my own. Now, the way that this vaccine is made you have to take a course to run this thing, don't you? It's like playing computer games. There we are. Now, what one does is to take a bacterial plasmid, cut the gene out that expresses the antigen that one wishes, and that's there in black. That's the foreign antigen. And you can pick out that gene and the antigen that it will produce, the gene that produces the antigen one wants, from any virus using recombinant DNA techniques, and putting it into a plasmid, which is a bacterial plasmid, and replicating it there in large amounts. Then one can take the way Dr. Moss and others have done this commonly is to co-infect a cell with the plasmid and with vaccinia virus. And by doing that, one will get the gene, the foreign gene that you're interested in. This really doesn't show as well. Get the foreign gene that one is interested in to recombine with the into the vaccinia virus. Now, this is done very cleverly, because the foreign gene is put is contained on either end with the thymidine kinase gene, also taken from the thymidine kinase gene is first cloned into the bacterial vector, the plasmid, then the gene that you want is inserted within that region. Then when one transfects the cell by recombination with the DNA of the vaccinia virus, recombination within the terminal regions that contains the thymidine kinase gene. Now, by inserting the foreign gene within the thymidine kinase gene, it produces, and recombining within that, it produces a defective thymidine kinase virus. Now, this has, using the thymidine kinase gene on either end, does two things for you in having a deletion in it. One, it permits the recombination event. And secondly, it gives one a selective marker. because the virus that does not have the thymidine kinase gene is not inhibited by such compounds as bromodeoxyuridine, which ordinarily will prevent the DNA of the vaccinia virus from replicating. So it acts as a selective marker, so you're not having a mixture of the recombinant virus and wild-type virus. And this is a very common way in which the vaccinia virus has been used, and as you'll see later, that the same method is being employed with other viruses. Now this is another perjury, and Brian Murphy, who lent me this slide, is sitting here in the audience, and it's the way in which the vaccinia virus is being used to reconstruct a vector vaccine with the respiratory syncytial virus. And the same technique was used. See, the thymidine kinase, here is the thymidine kinase gene, the respiratory syncytial virus G protein was inserted within the thymidine kinase gene, and also they used other genes to permit selection of this, since the thymidine, including the LAX-Z gene. Now in that way, the virus, one gets the G protein, which produces neutralizing antibody for respiratory syncytial virus, inserted within the vaccinia virus. Now this virus is then used in the same way in which one would immunize a person against vaccinia, and one theoretically will get antibodies to the vaccinia virus as well as to the G protein of the respiratory syncytial virus, and those antibodies should neutralize the virus when it enters if it's of high enough concentration. And as we'll talk about some of the problems that this gives us subsequently. Now, if the vaccinia virus is so good for vaccines, why do we deal with other viruses? Why don't we just use vaccinia virus for all vectors and not bother with other vaccine vectors? The major reason is that one gets immunity against the vaccine once it's used, against the vector. And so you can't repeatedly use it and necessarily get good infection any more than after you use the vaccine one does not get infected with smallpox for a period of time. So I think that no matter what vectors we use, we're probably going to have a whole library of different vectors in order to escape the immune response of each one. And one of the common ones, for the same reason that vaccinia has been popular, is adenovirus. It's been very well proven in the armed forces that there are strains of adenovirus which can be fed to humans very easily and not produce disease, because it's been a very successful vaccine in the armed forces, and millions of people have been immunized with the various types without any adverse effects. So this became a very useful, also very useful vector. And again, this is the adenovirus has been done by a somewhat different technique. And that is a large segment of the adenovirus, and here you can see running from 76.8 MAP units to 100 MAP units. That is the entire right-hand end of the genome has been cloned within the PBR plasmid so that large amounts of it could be made, and then inserted in a very simple region. One can insert a foreign gene as we see here. Now that is being done in a region, and I'll point it out to you in a moment, called the early region 3. And the region that's a very convenient place to insert it is that region, although it plays a real role in the pathogenesis of the disease, it's not a region that's essential for replication of the virus. So one can insert there and the virus will become a very effective replicating virus. Then by a different type of recombination, this piece of the DNA from adenovirus from 76 point, the whole, all about one quarter of the viral genome, is cut out of the plasmid and co-transfected into cells with the wild type DNA that's cut in a single place that goes from 0 to 85. Now, this sort of overlap permits a recombination event, so that one then obtains an intact living virus with the new gene inserted in the region that we call the early region 3, and as put here. Now, here it says envelope, and that could be the influenza envelope gene. It could be the HIV envelope gene. It could be from a variety of the of other viruses where neutralizing antibodies are made against that gene. This is just another example of how it can be done. This was done by Paul Hung and his group at Wyeth, and the HS stands for hepatitis surface antigen, which is the antigen which is necessary for producing immunity to hepatitis B virus. And it's inserted into the same region of the genome, the E3 region, which you see up there. And as I say, that whole region can be deleted without any effect on the viral replication, so that the same amount of virus is made whether that region is in or not. And two different types of vectors were made. Either the E region was deleted entirely or almost entirely, and the new gene put in there, or it was made as a vaccine, as you see here, using the deleted E3 with the hepatitis, or as shown above, without any deletion. The advantage of using the deleted virus is that packaging is much more efficient. In other words, in many viruses, the coating of the virus is a very rigid structure. And so only a very specific amount of DNA, or the genome, is allowed to enter there if the virus is going to assemble properly. So the advantage of deleting essentially the amount of genome that you're putting in the foreign gene permits much better packaging of the virus. And that's why this type of vaccine has an advantage, where you delete that region and then put in the new genome, the new gene. And this is just another example of a different type of insertion, and that is an insertion in which which was done with both the hepatitis B surface antigen or the HIV envelope, and it was done by insertion at the terminal region. Now, this virus, because of the packaging limitations that I mentioned previously, has some real disadvantages because the packaging is much more difficult. But in general, it has worked to a relative extent. And there are other ways these vectors have been made. There's been a vector made using the adenovirus in what we call the E1B region, and others in which we call the E1A region. And the success of those has not been demonstrated as yet, but they are being attempted and tried at the present time. Now, as I said, these are two viruses in which there's widespread immunity, or widespread immunity develops, particularly in the adult population, so that you can't continue to use them as vectors, and a whole variety of other viruses are being attempted. And here's one in which the varicella zoster virus has been used in order to as a vector. Now, the procedure is almost identical to that employed with vaccinia virus, and that is the gene that one wanted was cloned in a bacterial vector, and then it was, by recombination, it was done within the thymidine kinase gene of the vaccinia, of the varicella zoster virus, and by, again, homologous recombination, the new vector was prepared. And here is the the new, with the, all of the varicella zoster virus except the new gene which was inserted, and this happens to be the EB virus glycoprotein against which neutralizing viruses are made. Now the EB virus is particularly important because it's the virus that produces infectious mononucleosis, and it may have some role in a variety of different lymphomas, and that is not quite as clear to everybody. Now I guess that's... Then there is one other use of viral vectors which is different than for human which is different from that I mentioned. This also I obtained from Brian Murphy. And that is the use of a virus called the baculovirus. Baculovirus is a plant virus. The value of using it to make large amounts of antigen is one can replicate this virus to extremely high titers in plant cells, in cell culture. If you insert a gene, such as here, the type 3 parainfluenza virus, within the baculovirus, one can make very large amounts of protein in the cell culture, the plant cell culture, and then purify that protein to use it as a vaccine. In other words, you're making a vaccine out of purified protein. It's been shown with a variety of proteins that one can make very effective vaccines that way. For example, one can make a very effective vaccine for influenza virus out of the hemagglutinin gene product, the hemagglutinin of influenza virus. It's not done because it's commercially not, it costs a lot to do it, and therefore the pharmaceutical houses have apparently not desired to do it, to make a vaccine that way. But one would eradicate, as far as one can tell, the bad reactions that one gets to our presently used vaccine. So this type of vector, even though it's not as convenient to use as a vector such as adenovirus where one can feed it, or vaccinia virus where one can merely scratch the skin, this requires injections and therefore is much more difficult to use, particularly on a worldwide basis in a number of the developing countries. So widespread this will be, but my guess is that in the future, in this country, that it will be successfully used. Could I have the lights, please? I think that was the last slide. Now, this isn't all of the viruses that are being attempted to use as vectors. There are many more. For example, poliomyelitis virus has been shown that it can be a very successful vector. Herpes simplex virus can be used as a vector. Whether that can be attenuated sufficiently in order for it actually to be used in the population is not clear. And one can go through a whole list of viruses where we have particularly, the ones that are of particularly value are those in which we already have an attenuated viral vaccine from a virus to use that as a vector. And that's one of the advantages of poliomyelitis virus. We have the live virus vaccines. They've been shown to be at least relatively safe. There is a rare reversion, but it's not a very common event, and it depends upon how severe the disease is that you're trying to prevent as to whether one will ever use it. But we certainly have found polio virus to be a very successful vaccine, even though there are occasional reversions and occasional disease produced by the vaccine itself. It has done an extremely good job in lowering the incidence of poliomyelitis and even eradicating it in some small countries. So it's my prediction that there'll be a number of different viruses used as vectors, but I think that in almost all of the cases, they're going to be viruses, one in which you can prove the safety of them, and probably most likely those in which the safety has already been proven by a variety of other clinical trials. And again, I'll repeat the advantages of having a variety of vectors is that we're going to have a lot of diseases out there that we're going to want to prevent, and so we want to be able to change vector after vector to escape the immunity that the previous vector, viral vector, would produce. Now, there's both good news and bad news relative to the virus vector business. The good news is that using all of the modern technology of molecular biology, molecular virology, they're really quite easy to construct. And if we have the right vector, we can do very well. Certainly in cell cultures, these recombinant vaccines are very well expressed. Both the antigens for both the vector and the new viral gene put in are both very well expressed. And usually, in experimental animals, they produce good antibody production against both of them. The other good news is that it appears that these live viral vectors, just as the live virus vaccines, produce both cellular and humoral immunity. And if we have diseases in which that combination is advantageous, or if just cellular immunity is alone is what is really needed, it appears that it will be possible to do this with the viral vector vaccines. Then what is the bad news? The bad news is that in examples that have now been tested in the proper animal models, we don't always get the same antibody production that we got in other events, even though in cell culture they're perfectly visible. And I don't think that Dr. Murphy will mind that I say that this has been one of the problems with respiratory syncytial virus in a vaccinia vector. Although it made good antibodies in simple tests, such as in mice, when put into the chimpanzees where they could be challenged with respiratory syncytial virus, the good immunity was not produced to the respiratory syncytial virus antigen. The reasons for this, it doesn't mean that it can't be solved, the reasons are still somewhat unusual, but it's the idea is why one wants to go to a variety of viruses, and perhaps this can be solved by just having a different viral vector. Now, it may be the way the antigen was produced, the way it was inserted, or there may be a very different reason for it. And this has to be, theoretically, it should be an extremely effective way of producing it. Now, the other part of the bad news is that I'm not sure it is bad news. If one looks at the adenovirus where one dilutes deletes the E3, and you look in certain animal models, this actually does something that is unexpected and increases the virulence, produces a much more severe disease than the wild-type virus. Now, this seems unlikely to happen in the general population of humans because the viruses with deleted E3 regions are very common in our population. And yet, there's absolutely no evidence that in the diseases produced, that they have become the predominant virus to produce the disease. So even though in an experimental model it may appear to increase virulence, it may well be that in the general population it's not going to have any, when fed or even as spread in the respiratory route, that it will actually do this. So that animal models and humans may not always be the same things, and eventually, even though some people may object both to our use of animals and to our use of humans, eventually, if you're going to produce a vaccine, one is going to have to get back to the humans in order to test it. Now, there's obviously problems that we have to face, but I think the hopes are high. I think there's good reason to be encouraged, and hopefully we'll be able to have new and good vaccines against the viruses that are still plaguing us. Thank you.